grandfather would say, the land knows no color. Never mistreated anybody. You know, people do.
This is the story of an injustice that begins with slavery, continues through decades of government-sponsored discrimination, and even now is a fight for survival. Black farmers have faced discrimination for centuries. And today, there's fewer than 49,000 of them in the U.S. That's less than the entire student body of the University of Texas.
We had to fight for the land, fight for the equipment. But the white farmers around here, their land was inherited down.
Black farmers lost 80% of their land between 1910 and 2007, in large part because of systemic racial discrimination.
Folks are starting to realize that we don't actually have a future of farming unless we include all of the various ethnicities and races in this nation.
Leah Penniman knows a lot about the history of Black farmers in the U.S., in part because her grandmother was a farmer.
A lot of people don't know that the 12.5 million Africans who were kidnapped from their home were mostly rounded up because they were expert agriculturalists.
Even after the Civil War ended, the government never delivered on its promise of reparations. It said it would give freed people a plot no larger than 40 acres and a mule. It didn't.
Despite the fact that the promise never happened, we did manage to save enough money to purchase 16 million acres of land by 1910.
Black farming hit its peak in 1920, when nearly a million black farmers worked the land. Many black families across the South were sharecroppers. That meant they'd rent and farm small plots of land, and then the landowner would receive part of their crop. But high interest rates and unpredictable harvests often left sharecroppers, like John Boyd Jr.'s grandfather, indebted to landowners.
He would always wind up owing Mr. Hopper money, and I couldn't figure that out. I said, how in the same world do you work all year, harvest a crop, and you actually owe the plantation owner money?
John is a fourth-generation farmer and the founder of the National Black Farmers Association. His family story is one with a landscape fertilized by black labor. He is part of the 1.4% of black people who make up the country's 3.4 million farmers. The U.S. government has restricted the success of black farmers, and John would become a driver in their fight for equity.
I call the USDA the last plantation, the way that they're treated black farmers. We've been degraded and humiliated.
For decades, the U.S. Department of Agriculture systematically favored white farmers by denying loans to black farmers. Like his grandfather, John found himself financially struggling to keep his farm. He went to the USDA for aid, and the intense confrontation with the local USDA loan officer nearly ended in a physical fight.
A farm operating loan and the USDA loan officer, they spat on me. I just lost it. I literally wanted to whoop his ass. He said, if you don't learn how to talk to me, you're never going to get a loan in this county.
The Department of Agriculture is often the last resort for farmers when they don't qualify for loans from other sources. And discrimination was widespread at its local branches, which were largely run by all-white county committees.
We filed 3 applications at the USDA, and 6 months later, they claimed they had lost those loans or they couldn't find them.
Lester Bonner is a 74-year-old farmer from an agricultural family, and he says his fight with the USDA started in 1983. The land Bonner and his family tilled for 18 years was owned by a white man who promised them they'd get the first opportunity to purchase the grounds. But the government didn't make that easy.
We sit in the yard 2-3 hours, a couple of days, waiting on the guy, say he was going to come out and we'll fill the papers out. Nobody never showed.
Throughout the 1990s, it took an average of 60 days for white farmers to get their loan applications processed. But for black farmers, it took 220 days. Stories of unfair lending practices were so common among black farmers that a group of them, including John Boyd Jr., banded together. Their fight led John and 400 others to sue the government in a class action lawsuit known as Pickford versus Glickman in 1997.
I did a lot of the legal work because lawyers said there's no way you're going to win suing the federal government, especially a group of blacks to get paid for something, compensated for something, was taboo. It had never been done before.
But the black farmers did win. Well, kind of. The government settled the case for a little more than $1 billion.
The black farmers' case was like the next biggest thing to the Voting Rights Act as far as meaningful things that happened to black people in this country. A drop in the bucket for what happened from slavery to Jim Crow to sharecropping.
Nearly 16,000 farmers affected would receive $50,000. Some other farmers received more, but that was only if they filed their claims by a certain date. Many didn't, so Boyd found himself again fighting for nearly 40,000 claimants.
I can tell you, this took 30 years to do so. It wasn't something that transpired over a few years. We're talking about a 30-year period before farmers received their final checks out of the second lawsuit.
The follow-up case, known as Pigford II, gave claimants an additional $1.25 billion in compensation. But for many black farmers, it was too late.
You know, the plaintiffs were in their 80s and 90s. It was important because it showed the nation that black farmers did not decline because of a lack of skill or a desire to leave the land.
Today, the average age of black farmers in the U.S. is about 60. And Leah Penniman's life mission is to cultivate the next generation of young black farmers. Her program at Soul Fire Farm works with black farmers who are mostly in their 20s and 30s, offering week-long immersion courses.
Gives me hope, this sense that our generation is awakening to the call of coming back to the land.
Leah wants to show that young black farmers can still connect with the land, despite everything previous generations have endured.
Land is the basis of freedom, dignity, and equality. It allows people in our community to see more broadly what's possible for them and that they don't have to settle for what society has been told are the limits of what they can do.